Hello everyone, this is Jozef Nagy here, and in this video I'm going to talk about parallel simulations and how you can speed up your calculations by running parallel simulations in OpenFOAM. Here, the goals are the following. I want you to understand parallelization and how to run a parallel case in OpenFOAM. I'm going to show you the case setup and the differences between a single case and a parallel case. And I want to visualize the decomposition. I'm going to come to a little bit later. And I'm going to run a simulation of the depth charge case in the 2D. And you are going to run the simulations in 3D because the simulations take a while. And I'm going to post-process a little bit. So the geometry looks like this, at least the two-dimensional geometry looks like this. We have more or less a tank with four walls here. And in the bottom, we have water at one bar. In the top, we have air at one bar. And within the water, we have a gas bubble, so in 2D, a circle. And within this gas bubble, we have, again, air at 10 bar. So this case simulates charge exploding within water, and then the high pressure gas is driving the liquid in the direction of the walls and to the top. And then we will take a look at the flow and the free surface flow here in this case. For this, we will use the compressible interfoam solver. The official description is that it is a solver for two compressible isothermal immiscible fluids using a volume of fluid phase fraction based interface capturing approach. So, important is that the solver is compressible. It is a transient solver. You can use it for both laminar and turbulent flows. It is a multi-phase solver, and we assume that the phases are immiscible. It is uses the volume of fluid method, and in the official description it says it is isothermal, but this is not true. It is most definitely a non-isothermal solver. You can take a look at the source code. There is a temperature equation in it, so this is a copy-paste error, I guess, from older versions of compressible interfoam. So important is that it is non-isothermal. But I don't want to consider the theory in detail, because in this tutorial I want to talk about parallelization and not multi-phase compressible flows. Okay, let's come to parallel simulations. Now, up until now we ran our simulations in single mode, which meant that we set up the case and then we typed in simple foam or piezofoam or interfoam, or in this case we could type in compressible interfoam, and then we pressed enter, and then the simulation ran. We had some output in the terminal and the calculation of the matrix equations, like for the Navier-Stokes equations or the pressure equation. Well, the solution ran on one core. If you take a look at your PC or your laptop, whatever you're using, you most probably have a sticker on it where it says Intel Inside, Core i7, i5, i3, or something with AMD, and this shows you that you have either an Intel processor or an AMD processor. If you have an older PC, then you might have something else on the sticker, but usually you have a processor with four cores. This means that this processor can handle at least four processes at the same time. And the question is, why did we only run the entire simulation on one core if we have three additional cores that we could use for the simulation? We could run four simulations with different parameters. But what if I want to do one simulation without any parameter studies, but I want to accelerate the simulations by using all four cores for the simulation? This is possible, but the question is how to tell your PC or laptop which parts of the simulations to calculate on core number one, then core number 2, 3, and 4. How do you divide up your case? How do the cores communicate and exchange data? And I'm going to explain this now. I'm going to start with the case setup, how to divide up your case setup. There are different decomposition methods, and what is actually being done in OpenFOAM, you divide up your mesh. So for example, if I want to do a 2x parallel simulations, then what I could do, I could cut my geometry in the center, and then the left hand side will be calculated on core number 1, and the right hand side will be calculated on core number 2. And for that, I'm going to bring up here the user guide on page 79, and then you have a chapter on running applications in parallel. You can take a look at it. And actually, there are a couple of methods how to cut your, how to decompose your mesh into several parts. 2, 4, if you have more processors in your PC, if you have a simulation PC, then maybe 8 or 16 or even more cores, how to divide up your mesh. And there are, as I mentioned, different methods called simple, hierarchical, Scotch, manual, and there is this fifth one called Metis. And what they do, they are dividing up your mesh in a different manner. With simple, you simply just divide up according to the Cartesian coordinates. So for example, here, if the direction from the left hand side to the right hand side is the x direction, then we would have two domains in the x direction, one in the y from the bottom to the top, and then one in the z. And this is how you do it. For example, here you have four domains, so here we would run a 4x parallel simulation with the simple decomposition method, and here they defined two in the x and two in the y direction. Hierarchical is very, very similar. If I come here to the coefficients that we have to specify, it's very similar to simple. So we give the number of subdomains in the x, y, and z direction, here also x, y, and z. But in the hierarchical method, you can also specify the order of decomposition. So x, y, and z, or we could change this to x, z, and y, or y, x, and z, and so on. So here you can change the order of the decomposition. Scotch and Metis uses a certain algorithm, a certain strategy, how to divide up your mesh. And sometimes this is good, sometimes this is bad. I come to that a little bit later, and actually you will have to decide for your own grid. And with the manual decomposition, you can tell OpenFOAM how to decompose your mesh manually. But I don't want to talk about manual decomposition at this point. I'm going to take a look at simple, hierarchical, and Scotch. So the simple geometrical decomposition in x, y, and z, and I'm going to show you Scotch for more complicated geometries. So this is simple and hierarchical for two subdomains in the x direction. I could also divide it up into the y direction. Then I would have 1, 2, and 1. So two the subdomains in the y direction. Or for 4x parallel simulations, I could divide up my domain into 4 subdomains in the x and the y direction, or as I mentioned here before, I could divide up my subdomains twice in the x and twice in the y direction. This is also possible. And as I mentioned, Scotch uses a certain algorithm to do that. The point is, why, when are you supposed to use simple or and when Scotch, so the special algorithms. The point is, if you do not have a certain geometric symmetry, like in this case, here, where you can really say that if you cut in the center, then you will have the same number of cells on the left and the right hand side. For example, if you have an inlet tube and an outlet tube, and you would use simple four times in the x direction, then you would cut it up like this, and then you would have only the inlet tube on one core and the outlet tube on the fourth core, and then on the second and the third you would have most of the cells, and then these two cores would take longer to calculate, and these core number one and four would be finished with the calculations, and they would wait for course number two and three with the calculations. So in this case, this simple geometrical decomposition in the x direction does not make sense. So it really depends on the geometry. If you have these symmetries, these geometrical symmetries, and you can tell OpenFOAM to cut at a certain point. Scotch will try and distribute your mesh so you have a more or less equal number of cells on each core, and it will also try to minimize the number of faces between the cores, and I will come to that a little bit later what that means. But at this point I would like to start with the actual parallelization, and I'm going to jump in, and for that I'm going to the tutorial folder of compressible interfoam and laminar. Very good. Okay, and now I'm going to run the two-dimensional simulation, and you will run the three-dimensional simulation as a homework. So I'm going to make a copy of the two-dimensional case, and I'm going to call it base case, and I'm going to make copies of this base case. Very good. Base case. Now let's just delete the all run scripts, because I'm going to do everything step by step. Now in zero we have different initial values. We have alpha.water, p, prgh, t and u. These are very similar to the interfoam case setup. So if you did not watch my tutorial on multiphase modeling, then go and watch it if you want to know what alpha, p and prgh and u are. Actually, you won't find t there. This is what I meant. Compressible interfoam is a non-isothermal solver, so we will have the liquid phase fraction alpha, p, prgh, the velocity, so the pressure values, and we also have a certain temperature here. If I go here into zero and take a look at the values, alpha here in the liquid phase fraction, we set up the field with zero in the entire domain, which means that we will have air at this point. Of course, our case looks differently. If I go back here, we need also water in our case, but we will do that with set fields, so don't worry. Important is that we have two boundaries called walls and default faces, and the walls are these four boundaries or actual walls of our tank. And for alpha, we set zero gradient, the von Neumann boundary condition, and since we are running two-dimensional simulation, we also have the empty direction, and we call these boundaries default faces. Let's remember that. So default faces is our empty direction. Good. Then let's take a look at P. In P, we initialize the pressure to be 1 bar, and we will calculate the pressure on the walls. And we initialize the values with 1 bar, and we have our empty direction called default faces. Now prgh is similar, 1 bar in the entire domain, and we are using fixed flux pressure, and I'm not going to talk about this special boundary condition because I want to concentrate on parallelization. in this tutorial. And then we have default faces again. Good, then let's take a look at T. For the temperature, we initialize the value with 300 Kelvin and we are using zero gradient on the walls, which means that the temperature gradient is zero, so we don't have a heat flux out of the domain through the walls, which means that we have adiabatic walls. And again, we have default faces. Now for the velocity, we initialize the velocity with 0, 0, 0 in the entire domain, and we fix the velocity on the walls to be 0, 0, 0, which is the no slip boundary condition. And then we have the empty direction. However, for whatever reason, here it says front and back, so this is a mistake. Of course, up until now we called it default faces, so I'm going to correct this. If we left here front and back, then we would have an error message. So I'm changing this entry to default faces and I'm saving this. And as you see here, we have files with .org. These are the backup files because we are using set fields. So I'll have to create the actual files, alpha.water, then brgh, like this, then t, and now we have the initial values, all the initial values that we need. Okay, then let's go into constant. Let's take a look at g. We have gravitational acceleration in the negative y direction, so the negative y direction is from the top to the bottom. So once this explosion occurs, it will drive up the free surface and then the gravitational acceleration will pull back our water in the direction of our lower wall. At least this is our expectation of the flow. Let's take a look at it. So this is G. For LAS, we use a laminar model, so no turbulence modeling. In turbulence properties, we also use laminar, so it really is a laminar case. Then we have the thermophysical properties, and there is a big difference between interfoam and compressible interfoam. Let's take a look at thermophysical properties. Here we define the name of the first and the second phase. So we will have water and air. And important is that here the first phase will be represented by alpha equals 1 and the second phase will be represented by alpha equals 0. And alpha, the first phase, this name, water, has all to also appear here in zero. So it has to be alpha.water. If we would specify, for example, oil and air, then in zero we would have to call our file alpha.oil and not alpha.water. So take care. And here we also specify a limiting value for the pressure, a minimum value, and the surface tension between water and air. Now we have thermophysical properties dot air and dot water. Again, if we would have oil, then we would have to specify here thermophysical properties dot oil. So don't forget that. Let's take a look at the values of air, for example. And now you see that there is a difference between transport properties in interfoam and these thermophysical properties. I'm not going to explain you these models in detail. If you're interested in these models, you can find them in the source code in OpenFOAM, in your installation, in SRC, in thermophysical models and species. And for example, for the equation of state of the gas, because now it's not incompressible anymore, we are using the perfect gas model, which is the ideal gas law. And then you have to specify some constants for your gas. For example, the molar weight, then the specific heat capacity at constant pressure, and the chemical enthalpy. The chemical enthalpy is the enthalpy. If you want to calculate the absolute enthalpy, then you add up your sensible enthalpy, which is your Cp value times your temperature plus your chemical enthalpy. And we set this value to be zero. And then you define your dynamic viscosity, which is in this case in Pascal seconds. So it's not the kinematic viscosity like in InterFOAM. So take care of that. This is the density multiplied by your kinematic viscosity. And you can also define your Prandtl number for your gas. But again, take a look at the source code if you want to know what is happening in these models. Then for water, we have similar settings. Again, take a look at the source code for more detail. And we also define molar weight, and then for the equation of state, we define some constants. Here we are using the perfect fluid model, which is very similar to the perfect gas model. So very similar to the ideal gas law. We have a certain constant density and then a linear dependence on the pressure. Then we also define the heat capacity of water and the chemical enthalpy to be zero. And again, we are defining the dynamic viscosity and the Prandtl number of water. Good. Then in polymesh, we define our grid with block mesh. As you see, we have 8 vertices, 1 block, 80 cells in the X and 160 cells in the Y direction and 1 cell in the Z. And we have 4 boundaries for the walls. These are the 4 walls here. And we have 2 empty directions, which are called, for whatever reason, front and back. So this is inconsistent in this case. We have to use here also default faces. Very good. I save this now. I go out of polymesh and constant. Execute not Blender, but block mesh. Okay, before I forget it. And now let's take a look at system. Here we have control dict, FV schemes, FV solution, and set field dict. Let's take a look at those. Control dict. I will start from maybe from latest time. And I'm going to run the simulations until 0.5. I'm using this delta T, adjustable runtime, yes. And I'm going to use here uncompressed because I want to open up the files. So I'm using uncompressed here and a maximum grow or CFL number of 0.25. I'm saving this. This is good enough for me. Then maybe FV schemes. We are using Euler for DDT. Linear for the grad schemes. Linear uncorrected for the Laplacian scheme. Linear for the interpolation schemes, and for the divergence schemes we are using mostly the first order upwind scheme for the transport of our liquid phase fraction. We are using Van Leer and Linear. Okay, but I'm just leaving this as it is. I'm not going to change anything here or in FB solution. I'm leaving here the matrix solvers as they are set and the tolerances as well. And I'm also going to leave the number of inner and outer iterations. If you want to know what these means, then go and check my previous tutorials. Okay, and now as for set fields. Here at first we set the default values, so all the cells to be 1 for the alpha. So now we change our gas with liquid. So we will have liquid in our entire domain at this point. Then we set the pressure values to 1 bar. We also already had these values in our initial files, and the temperature to be 300, which we also had. And then we defined two regions, a sphere and a box. And we set this sphere here into our water, in the center of our water, with a radius of 0.1. And there, within this sphere, we set alpha to be 0, so air, and the pressure to be 10 bar, and the temperature to be 578 Kelvin. And then we define a box, and within this box we set alpha to be 0. So this is our air in the top here. Okay, so now I execute set fields. And what just happened? In 0, for example, in alpha.water, now we have a list of 1s and zeros, 12,800 entries of 1s and zeros. If I go down, it's mostly 1s. At the beginning, I'm not going to go through the file. Why 12,800 entries? Because we have 12,800 cells. Same is true for the pressure, for example, PRGH. Here we have 1 bar, and then hopefully after a while we will have 10 bar somewhere. Yeah, you can browse through this file if you want. I'm not going to do that. Good, at this point we could just type in compressible interfoam. And the simulation would run, but I'm stopping the simulations because I don't want to run a single simulation, but a parallel simulation. So for that, I'm going out of the base case, and now I'm going to copies of the base case depth charge to the base case, and I'm going to make three cases with the different decomposition methods. So I'm going to call the first one simple. Oops, forgot the minus R. Yes, okay, then hierarchical and the scotch. Very good. Now we have our three case folders, and now I could start with a parallelization. But at this point, I would like to stop recording now. I hope that you enjoyed this first part of the tutorial and that you learned something. I would like to thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the second part of the tutorial.